Professor CNR Rao, Professor G. Kulkarni, faculty colleagues and students, and other members of UNCSR. Good evening to all of you. On behalf of School of Advanced Materials, I welcome you all to this exceptional event. Felicitations to the winners of Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award 2020, Professor Subhi George in Chemical Sciences, and Professor Rajesh Ganapathy in Physical Sciences. It is indeed a great moment and pride for all of us. The Bhatnagar Award is the most coveted prize or recognition in science and technology in India. The winners have been doing very high level science since they joined in GNCSR. And let us congratulate both of them. I request all of you to unmute your microphone for 5 seconds. And let's give a big applause. Congratulations, Professor Subhi George and Professor Rajesh Ganapathy. So, actually, you know, last year we have made a wonderful arrangement for this, and Professor Tapas Kumar Maji received this award. We did a wonderful arrangement, but unfortunately, this COVID has made us a really difficult time, and we are not able to do anything much better than this. And Professor Rao also could not join because of this COVID, and he has given, however, a note to read. So I will read that. Dear Subhi and Rajesh, you have gained prominence in separate fields of activity. May I wish the fond hope of celebrating even more outstanding successes in other fields of endeavors. Ever increasing competition in difficult fields makes even that difficult. I am wishing you success in the future, and all the more best wishes for success in all the efforts you may make. May I wish you a better horse with even more lucky strikes. Wishing you both the best of luck. Professor Rao. He's online. So next, I request Professor, the president of GNCSR, Professor G. Kulkarni, to greet the winners.
Thank you, Professor Sundaresan. Professor Rao, colleagues and students, good afternoon. It is a pleasure taking part in this event. Two of our colleagues have been selected to receive the prestigious CSIR Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prizes 2020. Professor Subhi Jacob George in the area of chemical sciences and Professor Rajesh Ganapathy in physical sciences. Congratulations to both of you. Rajesh is online. The Bhatnagar Prize, as we know, is a recognition of the outstanding scientific research carried out by young recipients within the country. And I'm glad to mention here that we have many examples from the center in the past years. We have more than a dozen Bhatnagaris on the campus. This year is unique. It's a matter of pride that the center bagged 2 prizes. An earlier occasion like this was in 2010. We had 2 colleagues bringing the prize to the campus. On behalf of the center, on my own behalf, Subhi, Rajesh, please accept our heartfelt congratulations. And I hope that you will bring in many more such recognitions in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Kulkarni. May I request now Professor Sopan Pati to introduce or greet the winners and then introduce the speakers for me.
So now that Professor Subi Jacob George will be giving lecture on his some of his work. Basically, he is a supramolecular chemist and he works on designing and synthesizing molecules, supramolecules, and spatiotemporal control and living polymerization. This part we'll be talking today. Also, he does room temperature phosphorescence, stable up to days after days, and different color. And because of his great research and fantastic achievement, he has been awarded this Hansel Bhatnagar Prize. Congratulations, Subi, and look forward to hearing from you.
So, thank you, Professor Sapnapati, for your kind introduction, and good evening, everyone. At the outset, let me thank Professor Sundareshan, Professor Sapnapati, Professor Ishramurthy, and all India School of Advanced Materials team for this kind gesture. It's a great honor and happy moment for me to be here. I also take this opportunity to thank Professor Sena Rao and Professor Kulkarni for the kind wishes, which means a lot to me. So I take this opportunity to thank everyone who has supported for this success. But before I go to my talk, I would like to really thank Professor Sena Rao for his continued support since the day I joined GNCSR in the new chemistry unit. He has been a critical mentor for me. He has been a fatherly figure for me who kind of supports, consoles, helps all through all difficult times. And his dedication to science and his symbol, his presence make a lot of difference on all of us. And I take this opportunity to dedicate this talk to Professor Rao's 70 years of glorious scientific research. And I really thank him for all the support he has been providing us all throughout these years. And this has been acknowledged in one of my latest undergraduate paper, which I really dedicate to Professor Rao for all the wonderful support he has provided to me. And also, I'm blessed that it's my first scientific paper, independent science, once I joined GNCSR, was with Professor Rao, and is one of the most cited papers in my career. So thank you, Professor Rao, and thank you for being there, listening to me, thanks a lot. Coming back to my talk, my lab, which is again given by Professor Rao, the name of my laboratory, Supramolecular C. We are supramolecular chemists. We are working on organic synthesis, molecular self-assembly, and with the ultimate aim of making dynamic and adaptive soft materials. Our group basically are trying to push the concept of molecular self-assembly to more complexity and trying to bring novel functions out of it. So the kind of talk today I will be talking about mainly on this dynamic supramolecular polymers, which is a kind of field which has picked up a lot of momentum during the last two decades, and it's a kind of one of the most important research area. But on the other hand, most of the time, conjugated molecules is a kind of integral part of our design, and so that we try work extensively on, as Professor Sapnapati mentioned, optoelectronic materials, and one of our recent attempts is to make room temperature afterglow phosphorescence and so on, and we also work on novel properties like TADF, thermally activated delayed fluorescence, and circularly polarized luminescence. So basically what we are trying to do in these two topics, like the soft hybrids and organic optoelectronics, is use the concept of molecular self-assembly to improve the order in the material and thereby improving the function in all these organic materials. But coming back to today's topic, which is about dynamic supramolecular polymers. And as you can see this in this animation, the supramolecular polymers are very similar to the classical polymers in terms of its long chain structure. But only difference is that unlike the classical covalent polymers, where the individual subunits are linked by strong covalent bonds, here these individual monomers are linked by very weak interactions. As a result, we can easily break them, we can reform them, and thereby give a kind of dynamic or adaptive properties to these materials. What I mean is the monomers are in a kind of continuous exchange between the backbone of this material and outside. So it's a kind of, the exchange rate depends on the design what we are doing. So the last 2 years, the field has developed and is kind of important research field. gray areas are there. Like, and our group has been trying to address these aspects, like the basic mechanistic studies, control over its structure, like dispersity, precision, sequence, and also going to more kind of multi-component structures. And very recently, we are now trying to make more like a biomimetic system, moving away from equilibrium to non-equilibrium systems. So I will tell some of these aspects during this my talk. And also, I feel that it's very apt and right time to talk about this kind of new fascinating materials because this year we are celebrating 100 years of micromolecular chemistry. And this was in like 1920 with his classical paper, Staudinger proposed the concept of what is a polymer. Because this was in contrary to most of the prevailing ideas at that time, he proposed that these monomers are linked by covalent bonds. And this an idea which has got criticized heavily by most of the famous chemists, and it took for a while before this Johannes Kalothers, who started synthesizing these molecules in the laboratory, polymers in the laboratory. So it's, I think it's a perfect tribute to this 100 years of micromolecular chemistry that we talk about this new kind of fascinating material, supramolecular polymers. This area, as I thought, was very active for last two decades. The initial challenge in this field was to make this high molecular weight, because you know that these kind of systems rely on weak interactions. As a result, you need strong association constant groups which are having high association constant to get a significant molecular weight to show its materialistic properties like viscosity or which is characteristic of polymers. So probably like the first 10 years organic chemists ruled this field where they were trying to make new and new materials which has a very high association constant and has long polymer chain length. And there, the breakthrough happened probably like in, so the potential really started like probably like after 2005, when people realized that this kind of new systems in all aspects is very similar to the classical covalent polymers. For example, they show mechanisms very similar to the step growth and chain growth polymerization, which is well known in classical systems. And in supramolecular polymers, people call it as a kind of isolecic, which is analogous to the step growth, and nucleation growth, which is analogous to the chain growth. And this is at this time people thought, yes, we can indeed manipulate this basic understanding of mechanistic insights into the system, helped us to make more and more complex system. I was really lucky that I could grow along with the field, because it is almost the same time when I started my PhD, I could really, this field also started. So I could, that helped me to understand the challenging problems in this particular field. And also, very recently, we have a kind of better understanding on complete energy landscape of these kind of supramolecular polymers, which really again helps us to go and more complex system. So let's come to the our work. So the breakthrough work, I would say that we really started doing this supramolecular polymers is because of Chidambar Kulkarni, who is a kind of joint student between Bala and myself. And there was a kind of, he has undertaken a very extensive study by looking into, so one of the, our idea was that we need a predictive design for these monomers to tell them, let it follow a kind of isolecic mechanism or let it follow a kind of chain growth mechanism. Because if you want to make a real material, probably what we need molecules is kind of chain growth system or cooperative systems we tell. So he has predicted kind of based on the available database at that time, we had made a kind of bold proposal at that time, kind of long range interactions in the stacking direction of these monomers are indeed responsible for this nucleation growth. Some of the people had opposition to that concept. But later, with the help of many collaborators, we came up with a couple of systems to really prove that it is indeed our proposal was indeed valid. I would say this was the beginning time, like we got the confidence that we can indeed design this kind of systems the way we want, and we can move ahead with this. I just showed this slide because just to mention that this was the beginning of our research on supramolecular polymers. So one of the challenges we are trying to do is, one important aspect we try to address is we can make supramolecular polymers. One thing, any applications, if you look into it, we need a kind of structural control in this material. In this aspect, when you look into the classical polymers, there are many advantages. We can make them with a particular molecular weight. We can make them with a particular sequence. But none of these were possible in this kind of supramolecular polymers. The reason was understood based on the mechanistic insights we got. The reason was very simple. Unlike the classical polymers, where propagation step is something need to be controlled, in this case, in supramolecular polymers, this was the nucleation steps we need to control, because although nucleation step is a kind of energetically unfavorable process, most of the synthetic system, they have a very low actuation energy. So if you introduce another batch of the monomers to manipulate its degree of polymerization or its molecular weight, what happens that it starts its own individual nucleation. Okay, so as a system, we don't have a control on the dispersity or we don't have a control on its length of the system. So if you want to control the length of the system, as I shown this graph, or like this, if you want to make a multi-compound system by adding additional monomers, it is not possible. Okay, so people have come up with a kind of energy landscape, kind of trapping the monomers in a kind of metastable state, as shown here on the left side. People kind of buffer range of monomers to control this degree. So there was a kind of many attempts. But one of the basic drawbacks of this proposed idea was it is highly monomer specific. We cannot generalize this concept. It will work for one system and the energy landscape was completely different for another monomer. So this is not kind of, it's sure that it cannot come out as a generalized predictive design. So I will come back to that, how we address this problem. And another approach we wanted to get is like a temporal control of the supramolecular polymerization. Because if you look into the energy landscape and most of the synthetic system, what happens is since these bonds are very easy to form and break, they will easily find this thermodynamic equilibrium at the bottom of it. So once it reaches there, it is hardly changes. What I mean is that the complexity of self-organization only depends on the spatial organization, not like a kind of time or something. So once you make the material, they are stable. But this is completely different if you look into biological systems. Like this is a kind of microtubule self-assembly. If you look into the system, it's a kind of energetically uphill process, or people call it as kind of, it's a out of equilibrium self-assembly, where you need a continuous supply of energy for the system to remain in the functional state. And if you look into nature and cell, most of these functions comes out of such functional stage, which is not at equilibrium. And once the fuel is relaxed, it will come back to the ground state. So it is very clear that if you want to move away from this equilibrium to non-equilibrium systems, if you want to make more complex and more interesting materials. So keeping in mind this structural and temporal control, we started our research on this particular aspect, and we just looked into the design principle. And if you look into the design principle, they work in a very simple design manner, which easily chemists can mimic. So if you look into this, in both systems, unlike the synthetic strategies I mentioned, they exist in a kind of dormant monomeric state, okay, which is inactive state, and unless triggered by a kind of fuel, or we can say it's a kind of chemical reaction, then it starts growing. And the rate of the chemical reaction or rate of fuel binding controls the growth rate, okay, and we can know that as a chemist, we can control those chemical reactions by various external cues. So it's not a problem, we have a better control. So that controls the growth of the system. And then there will be a kind of complementary chemical reactions which controls the decay of this material. So from a chemist's point of view, we can think about two, one activating pathway and a deactivating pathway, and manipulate their rates in or concentration in such a way that this functional state is populated, and then after a while, this can disassemble. And so if you look into this approach, very nicely working most of the synthetic protein assemblies, they get very well-defined structures with a controlled degree of polymerization, and they get a kind of non-equilibrium material which forms and decay. And for a chemist, fuels are probably enzyme, a chemical reaction, or a redox state. So this is what exactly we try to extend into kind of, we call it as a kind of fuel-driven living and non-equilibrium polymerization or transient polymerization. We have come up with molecular designs. I don't have time to go to each and every design, but we have kind of designs like that. In this particular case, we have pockets where in the molecular there are receptors where ATPs and GTPs can bind, which triggers the self-assembly. Then they couple to two chemical reaction network. In this case, it's a kind of two enzymes. One is generating ATP and the other one is hydrolyzing the ATP, very similar to the actin design. We could create a kind of mimics of this kind of biological networks. We also extended it to kind of chemical reaction driven, and very recently we have shown that even redox chemistry can be used, oxidation and reduction kind of complementary couple can be attached to this kind of systems. So this is general. So what we gain out of this, okay, one of the things that very simple is like, this is very similar to most of the biological self-assembly process. All this system shows kind of fuel-driven nucleation growth, okay? Advantage of such a system, as I mentioned, fuel controls the rate of the reaction, so we can manipulate by external cues, okay? As a result, what we can do is that these are living system. We can come up with additional batch of monomers and keep growing. So that's why it is called a kind of living system. That way we can get a kind of controlled degree of polymerization. As you can see that we can do this process multiple times. It starts growing on its own chain ends. We get systems with highly monomer dispersed. We get a dispersity of like a 1.1, 1.2, which was really not possible with classical supramolecular polymeric systems, and we can control the degree of polymerization as well. And another, from a material perspective, we can also create a kind of something called transient material with this kind of coupling to two biological, so two chemical reaction network. Probably we can create a transient material, and this is quite different from classical stimuli responsive material, where you need a stimuli to form a material and need another stimuli to reverse it back. But in this case, both stimuli are acting together. What we do is we just delay the action of this material by controlling the concentration or rate of the reaction. So as I said, we can get a kind of transient material. What I mean is with the materials with a definite lifetime. That lifetime can be pre-programmed by the concentration of this chemical fuel. So you see that this forms, and this sometimes it can stay for hours depending on the kind of chemical things we are using. We are working on this kind of materials. We have kind of various concepts we are working on based on this transient material concepts. And also, it can lead to a kind of chemical reaction driven spatial temporal patterns like Turing patterns, which we are just getting into it. But something which we want to do further in this aspect is go to mimic other aspects of this natural self-assembly process. And if you look into a kind of acting self-assembly, also the microtubule self-assembly, the disassembly is catastrophic. In the sense, the strain is building up in the system and then suddenly it bursts. So we need to kind of build that strain in the system if you want to create forces out of it. So we now modify the design with something. The idea is to create a kind of kinetic bottleneck in the middle. So we came up with this modified design there, which we can couple to a kind of pH chemical reaction networks. And then because these molecules are not dynamic, so although it gets deprotonated, it will not disassemble. So the kind of strain is building up in the system, and at a point it overloads the attractive forces and then just bursts. And that's something which is we are trying to do it. And also such spatial temporal patterns, if you look into nature, like actins, they are able to put a kind of force on the cell membranes and make the cell moves. And this is exactly what we are trying to mimic now here. So this is these red colors are like kind of fluorescent coated beads put on these fibrous networks, where this oscillation happens, and we are able to kind of move this kind of generate a kind of force in the system. So this is something to mimic additional properties of these natural systems. We are pushing the system further. How many times open I have? So one more thing which we are now trying to do is, after getting this structural and temporal control, from a material perspective, ideal would be to go one step further in complexity. That is, can we go more than one component? Okay, so if you look into a block of polymers, the kind of structure I am talking about is a kind of two component system. For a block of polymer, you know that it is well used in lithography and photovoltaics and axial organic inorganic heterostructures, like a lot of applications like photocatalysis and energy conversion and so on. The question is, can we have an axial organic heterostructure with two complementary either optoelectronic, optical or electronic properties? Can we create a kind of axial heterostructure? And you can see that supramolecular block of polymerization is the only way, is the only bottom-up approach to make kind of axial organic heterostructures. And that's why so far such structures were not made. But then the problem is, so this has been done with non-dynamic monomers in the literature. But when it comes to a kind of highly dynamic monomers in solution, by just controlling the reactivity ratios between the monomers, can we make it? The one of the biggest issue here is the dynamics of the monomers. Okay, even if you make this kind of blocky structures, it can rearrange depending on whether it's a most thermodynamic stable state. It can move to either homopolymers or even kind of alternating polymers if the AB-AB interactions are larger. And another issue is how to characterize these structures, because we need a kind of subnanometer resolution characterization, and most of the time this organic structures are not stable with TM and all those things. So we need kind of super resolution microscopy techniques to characterize these structures. These are a couple of the challenges. And again, I am not going into the details, but what we have done is we found a very similar analogy with classical polymerization. In classical polymerization, this kind of block of polymers were synthesized either by two methods. One is by something called living polymerization, where chain ions are always active. The other one was kind of, if the reactivity ratios of the two monomers matches, they can just polymerize it. But if the reactivity ratio is somewhere around just less than above one, we get a blocky or segmented structures. And we realize that we can design monomers based on similar concepts in supramolecular polymers as well. And we found that if you are able to get the reactivity ratio just greater than one, we can do the reaction under thermodynamic control, and we can get a blocky structures like this. Or if it is able reactions are much stronger, we can never make this by under thermodynamic conditions. In this case, what we do is we make one block, and the way I mentioned about the living polymerization, sequentially add the second monomer into the second one, like a kind of under kinetic conditions. So don't worry about the details of the experiment. So these are the two different systems we shown this year, which belongs to the two extremes. One is thermodynamic conditions, and the other one is kinetic conditions. One is AB interactions are strong, the other one is AABB interactions are strong. And this is a bit, and you can see that we have cleverly chosen the core because we want to characterize it. So one is green fluorescent, one is red fluorescent. And then structurally there is not much mismatch because it's a core substituted naphthalene dimer, this kind of monomers are called. And you can see that these images are wonderful. With the help of cytotoxicity, we could image such wonderful heterostructures. It's nice to see that organic heterostructures where one is kind of one complementary optical, and we are now trying to extend it to p-n junctions and so on. So we looked into, with the help of Ivan from IIT Bombay, we looked into kind of individual axial organic heterostructures, and we have seen kind of interesting excitable migration properties, light harvesting and everything in this particular system. So this is the kind of new structures. Always we see inorganic heterostructures in this canvas. We can now come up with the organic heterostructures to challenge us to how to harvest this energy to a kind of reaction center. We need a kind of functionalization of these organic heterostructures. That's something which we are working on. Something which is very impressive is the excitable migration length, which goes more than a kind of 1 micrometer, which is because of the high order this self-assembly, supramolecular self-assembly, which is created in the system. So this is the kind of measure we were trying to do during the last few years on this kind of supramolecular polymerization. We are trying to do more and more complexity with the precision and function. And these are the three different areas we have been working on, kind of non-equilibrium system, multi-component system, and living system, where we want to make structures with high precision, with a high degree of polymerization, with a predefined degree of polymerization and dispersity. What do we do next? So the supramolecular polymers are very interesting material, but again, I should say that when you go to multi-component structures, one of the biggest challenges is characterization of the structure and its monomer sequence. So that's something which we really worry about. Two-component systems are okay, but as soon as we go to three-component system, the characterization tools are becoming highly challenging. What we need is a kind of predictive synthetic design. That's something which this field highly requires because most of the time, the design principles are specific to one particular monomer. We are now trying to generate some kind of design principles in this particular field of research. One thing which people are now seeing is a kind of recyclable plastics. Supramolecular polymers can be thinking about in terms of a recyclable plastics because monomers can be recovered and reuse it and remold it for addition polymer. This is, I think, at least we are not working, but the many groups are now looking into supramolecular polymers as an option to recyclable plastics. This is something which I get a lot of questions where I go, because in classical polymers, we can control the secondary structure. Branch structures can be made, multiple structures can be made. How do you make topology control? For example, if you ask me to make a kind of similar to inorganic heterostructures, can we make a kind of organic layer heterostructures? So this is something which we are very interested in process now. Only way to achieve such things is by tapping the secondary nucleation. And that's something which we are now trying to do, kind of secondary nucleation process coming into pictures, so that we can control layer formation in this kind of organic materials, and probably soon we can make a kind of even heterostructure, layered heterostructure in this kind of material. To that, I'd like to stop. Once again, I thank Professor Rao for having me in this wonderful new chemistry unit, which was a kind of interdisciplinary unit started in 2008. And I sincerely thank all my colleagues also from that, because it's a really vibrant and academic ambience in our department, which really helped us to carry out very good research. So thank you, Professor Rao, once again for that. And School of Advanced Materials is a wonderful platform. Even before it started, it was a very unique school, I would say, because you can find expertise from all the fields. So I have a wonderful collaboration with many of you in the School of Advanced Materials, which helped a lot in my success. Inorganic experts are there, characterization devices, computational and imaging. Recently, I mean, latest work, without the imaging expertise, I'm not able to sort it out. So thanks to Sajat MC for that. And also I have excellent collaborations outside the JNC. I just take this opportunity to thank them, especially from the molecular dynamics simulation point of view. Obviously, the none of the work would have been possible without the help of hard work of the students. So the success speaks the volumes of their dedication, their commitment, and so on. So I just really thank all of them for these are all the PhD students and also the other like mini postdocs, R&Ds. I take this opportunity to thank all of them and thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Mijakov George. So, now the next speaker, yes. The next speaker is Professor Rajesh Ganapati, who has received this Sansar Partner Prize in Physical Sciences this year. Congratulations, Rajesh. It's well deserved.
Thank you.
So Rajesh works on emergent phenomena. And both of them this year actually works on soft matter, actually. So Rajesh works on stochastic thermodynamics, glassy systems, heat engines, nano heat engines, and many emergent phenomena there. So Rajesh, today you'll be speaking on supercooled liquids on a SAR sphere. We'd like to hear from you. Thank you.
I'd like to begin by thanking Professor Kulkarni, Professor Sundaresan, and Samath. I'm really overwhelmed by this gesture. Very kind gesture. So it's both a delight and an honor, for me to be here and present some of the work that we've been doing. What you see on your screens, I'm not sure if the movies play as well as they are on my laptop, is you're basically looking at an emulsion droplet on which we have coated colloidal particles. So there are particles of two different sizes, which you see as green and red spheres. And in the smaller movie, you basically see particles also diffuse on the surface. What I'm going to tell you is, why did we start asking this question about what happens to liquids on a sphere? What got us to this stage? And I'll also briefly tell you about some of the findings from this study. Now, before I go forward, this is probably the most important slide that I have to share with you today. First and foremost, I would like to thank Professor Rao for making me part of the JNC research community about 10 years ago. His support and encouragement for the research that we do has been unparalleled, and I'd like to thank him for this. I am just really the mouthpiece of the talk. This is entirely done by a bunch of extremely talented and gifted students that I've had the opportunity to rub shoulders with. We have this very long-standing collaboration with Professor Ajay Sood. It's been a fun and very productive collaboration. I would like to thank ICMS, Samath, and the Department of Science and Technology for funding. And last but not the least, I would like to thank my family. I think the last time I thanked them was during the PhD thesis colloquium. I've taken them for granted, but I don't want to miss it out now. So coming back to the topic of my talk today, so we have been interested in looking at the glass transition problem for quite some time now. And so let me first tell you what the problem is. So let us say you start with a liquid and you cool it rapidly, so that you cool it rapidly enough so that you're able to bypass the formation of a crystal at, say, the melting temperature. And if you cool it fast enough, what's going to happen is the dynamics of the molecules is going to become slower and slower. At some point, the system is going to fall out of equilibrium, and you're going to have this disordered state of matter, which refuses to flow, and we call this the glass. Okay, and the temperature at which this undergoes this transition from a liquid state to the glass state is called the glass transition. And as you will see in this plot here, unlike the freezing transition at TM, depending on the cooling rate, where this transition happens depends upon how you cool the sample. Now, what is remarkable about the glass transition problem is the number of different systems that show it. For example, this is a pure metallic glass made of tantalum. And what I want you to draw your attention to is this cooling rate, which they manage. It's 10 to the 14 Kelvin per second. Okay, it's very difficult to wrap your head around such a large number, but they managed to do this in an experiment. So that's a pure metallic glass. This is amber, which is a tree resin. It's a polymeric glass. And I would like to point out this particular point, because I'm going to come to this in a slide or two, is amber, which basically encases a lot of these life forms that got encased in amber, it stays glassy for hundreds of millions of years. Okay. And this is a colloidal glass, so you're able to make glasses out of particles that are much, much bigger than atoms. So these particles are about a micrometer in size, so you can see them with an optical microscope. And you can also have glasses of living tissue. Okay, so this is a glass that is, this is basically a cell layer. And you see all aspects, sorry, not all aspects, many aspects of glass physics, even in these sort of assemblies of living cells. And so this is the overarching thing, that glass transition seems to occur in a whole variety of systems over a whole bunch of length scales. But the problem itself, if you were to recast it slightly differently, is this. So what I'm plotting for you here is the log of the viscosity or the relaxation time. So by the relaxation time, I mean the time it took for a molecule to diffuse its own diameter. What you see is that at TG, which is called the glass transition temperature, I marked it here with a dashed line. So if you go within this gray shaded region, you're really changing temperature by about 10%, and your viscosity or relaxation time grows by about 14 orders of magnitude. So imagine doing an experiment in a lab in which you're changing a knob by a small fraction of its radius and all of its overall circumference. And then what you end up is that you end up changing the output by 14 orders of magnitude, okay? So this is probably one of the most spectacular phenomena that you have in physics today, in condensed matter physics today. And even more spectacular is the number of theories that try to explain what's going on. Okay, so we know there is something called as the mode coupling theory. I will not go into the details, which we know doesn't capture the growth of relaxation times. But then there are these two very different theories. One is called dynamic facilitation, and if you'll see, the red line beautifully fits the relaxation time data. And there's also this theory called the random first order theory. And the green line also fits the data. They fit it so well that you can't even distinguish between them. And the spectacular thing about it is that these two theories have very, very different predictions about why such a slowing down happens. Okay, so to spare you the details, I'll tell you in very simple words what it means. It's the random first order theory basically tells you that the relaxation time becomes infinite at some finite temperature. So it is like a phase transition. So it's like a thermodynamic picture of glass formation. And the dynamical facilitation theory basically tells you that the relaxation times becomes infinite only when you go to T equal to zero Kelvin. Okay. And so this is, and the fact that just measuring relaxation times doesn't allow you to distinguish between these sort of scenarios has made this one of the toughest problems in condensed matter physics. And the real question is, how can colloid experiments contribute, if only a small way, to resolving this sort of a conflict? So I'm sure this audience knows everything about colloids, but just to bring everyone on the same page. So what are colloids? You're talking about small particles in a fluid. So this is, for example, particles that you can see in an optical microscope floating around in water due to Brownian motion. And the nice thing about colloids is that they are a micrometer in size, like I already told you. And as you change the number of particles in the sample, so you basically increase the number density of these particles, which you can quantify as a parameter called phi, you basically go from a liquid to a crystal. And along the way, you also encounter the glass. Okay. And what makes colloids fun to do these sort of experiments is because they are very large in size. They move around very slowly. Okay, so they are big enough to see and slow enough to follow, and you can do this with a simple optical microscope. Okay, and we exploited this very simple fact the fact that you can see things going on, to study a problem which has kind of eluded experiments for so far. This is just a digression from what I want to tell you, but I would like to point out this particular study. So I told you that amber stays crystal, amber stays glassy for millions of years. But once in a while, what a glass can do is it can also transform to a crystal, and we call this process as devitrification. And devitrification is something that you don't want when you're trying to cryopreserve samples. For example, amorphous drugs tend to dissolve faster than crystalline drugs, so you don't want drugs to crystalline. And of course, if you are a movie buff like me, if amber had crystallized, then all of those crystal facets would have torn through your mice entire DNA molecules, which means no Jurassic Park movies. Okay, but then what we managed to do very recently is that we took a colloid analog of a glass, and we were able to tweak the interaction potential between the particles such that something that happens over many tens of years or many hundreds of years could be compressed to within a few days, and we were able to basically watch what goes on. I don't know if this movie is playing, but basically in this movie what we are basically showing is you start from a glass, and I've sped up the movie by about a factor of 12,000, and you basically see how it transforms to a crystal. And all of this experiments, this probably the hardest experiment that I've been a part of, was done entirely by this one student of mine, Divya, who's shown the photo there. So coming back to the glass problem, the glass transition problem about how colloids can help solving the conundrum. All of it goes back to a beautiful study that was done about 2 decades ago. And this really started the sort of experiments that we've been doing and many others have been doing. So what you're seeing here, it's not a simulation, it is from real experimental data. It's basically a volume of a colloidal glass sample that's being imaged. The particles that are blue are particles that don't move as much, and the particles that are red are particles that move quite a bit. And one thing that this study basically found is that when you look at these when you look at the mobility of these particles, you find them clustered, and that is easy to understand. That if you are in a crowd, if you have to move forward or backward, you have to displace a whole bunch of neighbors around you. So you see these sort of clusters emerge. And what this study also showed is that as you start approaching the glass transition, basically these sort of clusters grow in size. Okay. And these sort of clusters are called, and for obvious reasons, we call them cooperatively rearranging regions. And this really opened the door to real space imaging of dynamics. And what we wanted to do is, people have been working, and we also made a small contribution to this, is can we exploit the fact that we can look at dynamics, we can manipulate colloidal particles, and start testing out theories. Okay, so we are going to have 2 theories in mind, but I'm going to show you results from very quickly from one particular theory, which is called the random first order theory, and can we actually start testing those. So a couple of years ago, what we did is we took one of these colloidal glass samples, and I hope you can see it in your movie here, there, that along the top, along the horizontal, we have used optical tweezers to basically freeze a wall of particles. And the prediction was that when you freeze a wall of particles and you look at how the rest of the sample evolves, and you start looking not just at the size of these cooperatively rearranging regions, but you also start looking at the shape, what we found is that the clusters of cooperatively rearranging particles are more string-like if you are at low enough density or low enough packing fraction. And as you cross this threshold, which I call phi MCT, and if you recall the blue line that I showed you, which didn't quite fit the relaxation time data, so that corresponds to phi MCT. Across this transition, you basically see that the shapes of these cooperatively rearranging regions goes from string-like to compact. And what is remarkable about this particular prediction is that this is unique to the random first order theory. No other theory of the glass transition anticipates this particular feature of cooperatively rearranging regions. So these experiments seem to suggest that that at least experimentally over the in a colloid sample over whatever limited phi we can explore, the random first order theory seems to capture data better. Okay, and the thing that we wanted to do is what happens when you take this random first order theory, which works beautifully in flat space, and now you start curving space. Okay, so just to tell you what I mean by curving space, let us say I take a flat sheet of paper, and on the flat sheet of paper, I basically triangulated it. So I've drawn triangles on it. And as you know, a flat sheet has zero curvature. So if I take a vertex and I basically go around the vertex, I have six triangles each making a pi by three angle. So if I subtract 2 pi from 6 times pi by 3, I get 0. So whenever I have zero curvature, it means that when I go around a circle, I'm going to exactly pick up 2 pi. So the angle deficit, which is basically this, is going to be 0. But let us say I do the following. I take the sheet of paper, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to basically cut out along this dashed line, and I'm going to merge this orange and the gray triangles. Okay, so instead of now having six triangles, I only have 5. And what it does is immediately, because the paper cannot tear, it can only bend, you basically start introducing curvature. And now if you go around this point, you basically now pick up an angle deficit of pi by 3 because you cut out one triangle. Okay, now we know what the total curvature of a sphere is. It's basically 4 pi. Don't worry about the Gauss Bonnet theorem. I'm just putting it there for people who know about this. Now, if you have a total curvature of a sphere to be 4 pi, then it means that the angle deficits must add up to the total curvature. So when you do triangulation on a sphere, of course, you will have hexagons, but you also have to have these pentagons. Okay, so if you have 12 of these pentagons, you get 4 pi, which adds up to the total curvature. And this is the reason that when you look at a soccer ball, you will have 12 pentagons. When you look at the poly building, which is inspired by the C60 molecule, you will see a pentagon there. When you look at a virus, you will once again see pentagons on the surface. And this is only an artist's rendering of the COVE-2, which has managed to terrorize us. So this COVE-2, at least in the artist's rendering, is mathematically correct. It does have a pentagon and has an hexagon. Okay? But unlike the volume fraction and temperature, which can drive a system to glass, because of the fact that putting in curvature also introduces these defects, pentagonal defects, it means you can also drive a system to glass by curving space. Okay. Not only that, I will only mention it in passing here, you can also reduce glassiness by curving space. For example, icosahedra, okay, cannot tile 3D Euclidean space, but for a suitable number of these icosahedra, you can perfectly tile a 4D hypersphere. You cannot show it in a 2D slide, and definitely not in 3 dimensions because of the dimensionality of the sphere. So what I'm trying to convey here is that besides temperature and density and pressure and other parameters, you can also tune the curvature of space to make a system glassy or make a system more crystalline, right? And all of this is captured by the theory called as the frustration-based theory of the glass transition. And what we wanted to find out is all of this RFOP mechanism that seems to work so well in flat space, does it also carry over to curved space? And this is something that had not been answered either in simulations or in experiments. So we set out to answer this question. Now, the experimental system itself is straightforward. So you basically have an immersion droplet, which is basically an oil in an aqueous phase. Inside the oil droplet, we have two different particles shown here by red and green. And what happens is these particles have a small surface charge. And because I have a dielectric interface right here, the black line, if you go to Jackson chapter 2, you will see that whenever I have a small charge on a surface and I bring it near a dielectric interface, it has to induce an image charge. Now, the induced charge is of an opposite sign, which means that this particle is attracted to sitting on the surface. Okay, that is all the system is. So we're going to take an immersion droplet and we're going to coat it with two colloids, or with colloids of two different sizes, and we're going to look at what happens. And the parameter that we're going to control, which drives the system into the glass, is called, we call it gamma. Now, the gamma parameter basically has a contribution coming in from the electrostatic interactions between particles and also the number of particles on the surface. Okay, so, but all you need to know is if I increase gamma, I'm going to drive the system to a glassy state. Okay, and what we're going to do is, once we have the system, we're basically going to image it using a confocal microscope, so we can image the complete volume of the sample. All right. So I'm going to start with some movies. So what you're looking at here is basically.
Rajesh, your screen has stopped. We're not able to see the screen.
Share the room with me.
I'm sorry. Is it with everybody or is it?
Yeah, most of us.
No, I can see it.
Yes.
I can see it.
I can also see.
Okay, go
ahead.
Should I pause?
Until
people get back on board?
Can we unshare and share again, Ravish?
Okay, I'll do that. Can you see it now?
Yes, Rajesh.
Okay.
Yes, Rajesh.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Rajesh. So, what I'm going to do is show you movies of what happens now. So, you're looking at a sphere, looking at the lower and the upper hemisphere, and this is for a particular gamma value. It's a low enough gamma value, and what you see is all these particles beautifully diffusing on the surface, and Navneet has done some mathematical wizardry to also show you the trajectories of these particles. Okay. Now, if I increase gamma, you'll see what happens. Naturally, the system is more frozen and particles don't move as much, everything as expected, okay? And so the next thing that we do is we are now going to go look for all these defects on the surface. I said pentagon is one sort of defect, but that's not the only defect that can be, right? So you can also have coordination defects of other, you can also have particles with other coordination numbers. And all of those which differ from a hexagon, I'm going to call it a defect. And what I've done is that, so a hexagon which gives you no curvature, I'm going to call it a defect of zero charge. A pentagon is plus one charge, a quadrilateral is plus two, heptagon is minus one, and an octagon is minus two. Okay? And you see all of these sort of defects tiling the surface of the sphere. But I also told you, according to the Gauss-Bonnet theorem, that if you were to add up all of these defects, you should precisely get 12. Okay, so now I'm plotting for you the number of defects, because this is just a static snapshot, but the movie evolves in time. I'm counting the defects in each frame, and what you find is that, of course, you have a large number of hexagons, but the pentagons are a little more than the heptagons, and you see that the net charge doesn't fluctuate at all. Okay, this is a mathematical requirement. There's no escaping this. This is just to show you that we have done the right analysis so far. Okay, so now that we have movies of what's going on, I'm sorry about this slide, but this is the heart of what gets us going further. All I'm trying to show you is a relaxation function for various gammas as a function of time. And now I told you as I increase gamma that the relaxation time should grow. So I have also drawn these intercepts here. And as you see that as I increase gamma, the relaxation time does grow. But the most important thing is if I were to look at how the relaxation time grows as a function of gamma, this is exactly according to the mode coupling theory, at least for a narrow window of supercooling, okay? Now, the next thing is, what we're going to do is look at cooperative dynamics. So I'm once again showing you a movie of the lower and the upper hemisphere. But now what I have done is I've averaged these movies over a reasonable amount of time. That time has got to do with the time it takes for a particle to move its own diameter, roughly. Okay? So if a particle has moved its own diameter, it will be blue in color. And if it is not being able to move, it will be magenta in color. Okay? And you, as you expect, in the low density regime, you have a homogeneous density field, okay? But as you increase density, it becomes spectacular, okay? So you have these sort of frozen particles that don't move at all, but once in a while, you also see the streaks of movement, okay? These are the cooperatively rearranging regions, but this is the first time somebody's been able to visualize them on the surface of a sphere, okay? Now what we're going to do is, in the spirit of R40, we're going to ask, what happens to the shape of these cooperatively rearranging regions? as you start approaching the glass transition. Right? And we are going to do a very simple analysis. Now, you will agree with me that if my cooperatively rearranging regions are string-like, it means that, one second please, it means that if I have a particle here, if it is string-like, I'll have one fast particle front of it and one fast particle behind it. Whereas if I have a more compact cooperatively rearranging region, this is what I will see. So what I'm going to do is plot the number of fast nearest neighbors to a fast particle. And as you will see that as you start increasing gamma, this peak shifts from 2 to 3. So you do have this compaction going on. And this is shapes of CRRs that I've shown you in flat space. So we found this compaction happening, and this is on a sphere. The key thing is, like I told you once, a few slides ago, that this compaction is very unique to the random pastorality. Okay, and that seems to be the case even when you start driving the glass by curving space, not by increasing density or temperature, just curve space, and still R4P seems to work. Okay, and this is the study that recently appeared. Just to reiterate, R4P predictions are valid even on curve space. But I'm sure you'll agree with me that a far more remarkable thing is that colloidal suspensions, which really started offering insights into these sort of phenomena about 2 to 3 decades ago, still remain powerful models to probe these sort of effects. And with that, I'd like to thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Rajesh Ganapathy, a wonderful talk, and thank to both the winners of Sansilk Prize, and now I hand over the mic to Professor Ishwarmurthy, so he said a few words and close the session.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you, Professor Subhi George and Professor Rajesh Ganapathy, for agreeing to give this special lecture in a short notice. Thanks a lot. And indeed, JNC is proud of your scintillating performance in our club success. This will give you more energy and enthusiasm, vigor and rigor for many exploratory expeditions. At this juncture, it is very apt to thank Professor C.M.R. Rao for creating the ecosystem at JNC where nothing matters, only science matters. I am sure this ambience animate JNC researchers to spring many surprises in their career and bring many laurels to this institute. So I'd also like to thank Professor Kulkarni, the President JNC SR, and the summit organizers, Professor Sundaresan, Professor Sapan Pati, and the administrations for their efforts and supports in organizing these lectures, special lectures. So, I finally thank P. Monika Vora and Tilly for the hall arrangement. And I want to say thank you all of you, for those who are attending online and offline these lectures. Thank you once again.